Good morning and welcome to this morning's meeting. I have apologies from David Torrance, but this morning we will continue to take evidence as part of our inquiry into alternative pathways to primary care. And welcome to our committee. Hang on, sorry, I have forgotten to ask you if you're content to take item 5 in private, members. We're content, thank you. And our second item today is a further evidence session that's part of our inquiry into alternative pathways to primary care. And I welcome to the committee Humza Yousaf, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. And accompanying the Cabinet Secretary online, we've got Scottish Government officials Noreen Ahmad, the Head of General Practice Policy Division, Tom Ferris, the Chief Dental Officer, Alison Strath, the Chief Pharmaceutical Officer, and Michelle Watts, the Senior Medical Advisor, all from the Scottish Government. Good morning to you all. Cabinet Secretary, I believe you've got a brief opening statement to make.
Just brief words, Kavina. Thank you so much, and good morning to you and to committee members. I hope you're all keeping safe and you're all keeping well. For one of your first inquiries, I'm really pleased and I'm very glad that you've chosen an area often referred to as the bedrock of our health and social care services, and often referred to as the front door for a number of people, for most people, when it comes to accessing the health service. I'm really impressed, by the way, that committee has gathered quite a diverse range of views in this inquiry, both from primary care providers, but also, very importantly, from the wider public who use those services. And it's been extremely interesting getting feedback and reading some of the feedback from those evidence sessions. I've read with interest the comments of contributors to the evidence sessions over the last number of months. These reflections point out that, like in most areas of health and social care, we've engaged in significant redesign of primary care both before and during the pandemic. It goes without saying that the contribution primary care service makes each day to the health and wellbeing of Scotland through continuity of care and meaningful relationships with patients is foundational to our public services. And let me take this opportunity to thank every single member of the primary care family for their incredible efforts during the pandemic. Prior to the pandemic, we were already engaged in significant reform of pathways through the 2018 GP contract. This has been a real step change in primary care pathways in the community, with people accessing a wider range of healthcare professionals through their practice, while freeing up GP time to focus on more complex care. By March 2021, 2,463 staff had been recruited to these MDTs, these multidisciplinary teams. That's over two and a half whole-time equivalents per practice. And that number will have risen significantly over this year. For our part, we've allocated every penny of the £360 million investment committed to recruit these teams over 4 years, and are delivering a further £170 million investment as part of the 22-23 budget to continue the expansion of these important MDTs. Injecting that additional capacity into practices has been a real boon in allowing our wider primary care system to respond flexibly to the pandemic, staffing COVID hubs and assessment centres, supporting the COVID vaccination rollout, while of course keeping core GP services going to address the wide array of patient issues. And of those core services, it's worth pointing out that even before the pandemic, video and telephone consultations were, of course, a part of how care was delivered in general practice. And while over time and as restrictions ease, the balance will shift towards more face-to-face appointments, as they should, a mixture of appointment types will remain a core part of general practice, as we know that it suits many patients to have their consultations with general practice over the telephone or over video. It's not just general practice that has adapted significantly throughout the pandemic and changed to meet the needs of its patients whilst keeping them safe. For example, we launched NHS Pharmacy First Scotland in summer 2020, seeing it increase the range of common clinical conditions which are able to be treated by the community pharmacist. NHS 24 has also seen a significant increase in demand over the past year as a consequence of COVID, expansion of mental health hubs and access through 111 to the national redesign of urgent care pathway, all delivered 24/7, where previously NHS 24 operated largely out of hours. Looking forward, as we look forward and look to the horizon and recover from the worst of this pandemic, it is important we continue to shape our pathways to address demand that has risen, and that we learn from the experience of the pandemic. GPs are, as I said earlier on, usually the first port of call for people seeking professional help for mental health issues, and the vast majority of mental health consultations occur in primary care, covering a diverse range of needs. That is why we are investing in 1,000 additional mental health workers in primary care by the end of this Parliament. Primary care services are often dealing with far more than clinical issues. That's why we're investing in providing non-clinical and social support and advice, including support for individuals experiencing social and financial disadvantage and exclusion, such as community links workers who can help with those concerns, welfare advisors, and indeed mental health workers. And we're committed to a range of recommendations tackling inequalities following a publication of an expert group last month. I see this focus on mental health and health inequalities as complementing and further developing the primary care reforms we have already instigated. To conclude, convener, more multidisciplinary, multi-agency working, shifting our focus to the community to ensure we get the right care to the people at the right time is what we will continue to commit our efforts towards. On that note, of course, I'm happy to take questions from the committee.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. So, as you've mentioned, it's been a number of years. It's been 2018 that the Scottish Government started the reforms on the pathways and the multidisciplinary teams. Previous to that, of course, it was a traditional model of the GP being the first and often the only port of call for people to get access to healthcare. But obviously, the plan is to widen that out. I mean, one of the reasons that we decided to do this inquiry was in speaking to stakeholders and getting a sense that maybe the public awareness around this isn't quite where it could be. And certainly we had responses in our survey from patients across Scotland and discussions with patient groups. And the model that the government want to promote isn't quite landing in every area of Scotland. And I just want to know your thoughts on how you think the government can take this forward and actually shape this culture change, but also giving that assurance to patients that an alternative pathway is not a wrong pathway. You don't have to see your GP for everything. In fact, it actually may be better to access an alternative pathway.
Yeah, look, I think that's a really fair comment, and I think it came out quite loud and clear from the various evidence sessions that you held as well. And that message, as I say, came across really clearly. I think there's a couple of points to make. One is for anybody that has accessed and had treatment from the various different members of a multidisciplinary team at a GP's practice, whether that's the physio, the advanced nurse practitioner, the pharmacist. The quality of the service that I hope the vast majority of people will have received will have been expert, it will have been really extraordinarily helpful to them. So one thing, I suppose, is the more and more people get access to those individuals, then I've got no doubt that they will absolutely understand the value of the multidisciplinary team model. But secondly, around the comms and the communication, this is something that's been raised with me by, as you'd imagine, not just patient groups, but also by clinical representative organisations such as the BMA and the Royal College of GPs, the latter of whom I met just a couple of weeks ago. And I think for me, a couple of things we can do. First of all, the work that we're doing with the Alliance, I think, is really important. The Alliance will be well known to you, convener, and committee members around this table. And we recently commissioned the Alliance to conduct a qualitative survey into patients' experience of accessing general practice. And this forms part of a wider 10-year monitoring and evaluation strategy of primary care. I think for us, the pandemic, and it's not to use the pandemic, it's been challenging, but I think one thing we can all recognise is so much of our marketing and in communication has gone into how to behave during COVID, the latest COVID regulations, the latest COVID rules around testing, self-isolation, etc., etc. I hope as we recover, and there'll still be COVID communication, in fact we're running a COVID Sense marketing campaign at the moment, But we can begin to rebalance some of that communication to the public, which is exactly about the redesign of urgent care programme. And actually, even if you're not seeing your GP, it might be better for you to see another member of the team at the GP practice or within the community. And as part of that, we delivered at the end of, and I'll finish on this point, at the end of last year, a leaflet to every single household, and it with an accompanying letter from the Chief Medical Officer and the National Clinical Director. And that leaflet, I think well produced, showed the various different alternative pathways for somebody to access treatment, including GPs and what services you can expect at GPs, but also the other pathways, including Pharmacy First, NHS 24, etc. So I take the point and don't disagree with it that there's got to be a bit of a cultural shift, and it's something that we're very focused on.
Mm. We certainly heard that. I think accessing your pharmacy and the minor ailments system there was something that probably has been more successful than others. And the Cabinet Secretary, do you see any areas in which specifically a little bit more work needs to be done in giving patients confidence, particularly the patients that will say, you know, I need to see my GP, and feel that they're actually been fobbed off by suggesting something else? I mean, I think that's a key point in terms of the cultural mindset that you can get.
I think you're absolutely spot on. It's why this month we've launched a campaign specifically to support our receptionists. I was at Tamount Surgery a couple of weeks ago, where I had a discussion with Dr. David Shackles of the Royal College of GPs. And, you know, you could just see how, I mean, immediately obvious from when you walk into the surgery, just how busy our receptionists are. And, you know, we've unfortunately heard reports of receptionists in particular facing abuse over the phone, sometimes in person, and it's completely unacceptable. I think everybody around this table would agree, completely unacceptable. It doesn't matter the pressure that an individual is no doubt under, or their need to see a GP or a member of a GP practice, you know, aiming abuse at receptionists or any member of our health and social care staff is unacceptable. But clearly, there are people who feel that receptionist almost acts like a kind of gatekeeper. And so that's why we've launched this campaign this month to say, actually, when a receptionist is redirecting you, then it's being done because it's in the best interest of your clinical care. There may be others that can see you, and it allows the GP, hopefully, to focus on those complex cases as expert medical general practice, experts, and then I hope is a better experience for the GP, but also importantly a better experience for the people that we're looking to serve.
Just one final question before I go to Karen Walken. You mentioned a better experience for GPs. Obviously, taking the fact that GPs' workload is extremely pressurised, do you think that maybe if this model, when this model really starts to click in, and we have this public acceptance of the fact that there are a number of different ways, that it actually might make GP practice, general practice, very attractive to medical graduates, because they are dealing with the acute stuff, the stuff that's really going to put their training into action, as opposed to some of the other things that are, you know, the nurse practitioner side of things?
Yeah, that is certainly part of the feedback we get. You know, this focus on being an expert medical generalist is what I think certainly makes that option more attractive. I think easing the workload burden so they can, again, focus on those complex cases, I think that does help. I think there's other issues around retention as well. In fact, I'm very aware that I'm speaking while we have, of course, a practicing GP as part of this committee, and of course interested to hear his thoughts. But certainly the feedback we get from GPs is that this would definitely, the contract and the work we're doing around MDTs in particular, if we get this absolutely right and is embedded in, then certainly could make general practice a more attractive proposition. That being said, I mean, last year's fill rate was about 98%, so we're doing well in that. But retention, I think, is a really important point, and this could be key to that retention.
Thank you. Carol, you have some questions.
Thank you. Morning, Cabinet Secretary.
Morning.
I think it is clear from the evidence, and I'm really pleased that you have listen to the evidence that, you know, patients do see GPs as the gold standard. So it is understandable that they sometimes find this new way of working, or not so new now, but this alternative way of working quite difficult. And so it is our responsibility to try and support them to these new routes in a way that makes them feel, you know, engaged and valued and getting the best treatment. My question would be around patients, and the evidence is clear that we've taken, and also I get this in my constituency all the time, they do feel a bit passed around. They feel that the systems are not working very well, and that there's no clear leadership at, you know, the sort of health board levels about how these pathways work and what happens when you go all the way around the system and back again, because we have heard that quite a number of times. So I would suggest that there is some urgency around sorting this, and that some serious financial investment would probably be required. And I wonder where you are with that in your plans for the next coming few years.
Yeah, well, look, on the serious financial investment, you know, £360 million to deliver those multidisciplinary teams, I hope is a sign of our investment and the importance that we attach to this. So I hope we'd certainly meet that ambition. We also know, and I know Carol Mockin knows as well, as is the entire committee, the last two years have been absolutely unbelievable in terms of the pressure that everybody across the NHS and social care has faced. And if we did not have a pandemic, I don't doubt for a minute that we would be able to use more of our communications muscle and the weight of the government in terms of communication to get some of these key messages out. All that being said, I take Carol Mockin's point that actually during a pandemic, perhaps even more important to be doing that. In terms of people being passed around, it is something I hear too, and again, I think it's fair comment. From our perspective, it's why the work we've done and are doing in terms of the digital health and care strategy, which is available online, I'm certain members will have seen it. If you've not seen it, I would commend it to any committee member to look at. It lays the foundation for that cloud-based architecture where information can be shared a lot better than it currently is, and we know that's still an area that needs significant improvement. I do think, though, with the embedding of the likes of community link workers, for example, that the sharing of that information about a patient is better, and therefore, hopefully, people are not being passed around as much between whether it's third sector support, whether it's primary care, whether it's secondary care. And the last thing I would say is interface working between primary and secondary care is of extreme importance to us. And I have to say, every time I meet with the BMA and the Royal College of GPs, they stress to me just the importance of that interface working. So again, people aren't passed between primary and secondary care, which in fairness is a bit of an artificial boundary that we've created, as opposed to a kind of boundary that means anything to patients who just need to receive either treatment or diagnosis or care for the condition that they have.
Thank you. I think the key thing is to remember that the patients are central to it, and so their experiences are really important to move it forward. So I would urge the Cabinet Secretary to make sure that there is, you know, serious commitment put into alternative pathways, because we do all believe that it will have good outcomes for patients. Thank you. Thank you.
Move on to talking about workforce and capacity, and Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Convener, and welcome this morning, Cabinet Secretary. So, changing the way the public access primary care is key to really make this a reality. Alternative pathways must deliver for our patients. So, in evidence, we've heard about long waiting lists that can encourage patients to default back to the GP, if you like. So, how will the Scottish Government improve staff capacity and reduce waiting times? And is there enough investment in recruiting staff to deliver the Scottish Government's vision?
Yes, it's a really good and important question. There's no getting away from the fact the last 2 years have seen significant increases in backlogs and waiting on a waiting list. And this is a really important point that was stressed to me by a number of orthopaedic consultants that I met with recently, that waiting on a waiting list is not a benign act. You know, it's not benign. It comes with real, serious, significant impacts on the individual that is waiting, and that can be a deterioration in their health. It can be increased chronic pain, and therefore, if they do not know how long it will be until their procedure or their operation, then to manage that, they'll often go to primary care and often to GP practice. So I entirely accept the point that as the backlog continues for treatment, then there will undoubtedly continue to be a level of pressure from that backlog onto primary care. So tackling the backlog is key to that. And key to tackling the backlog is controlling transmission of COVID. We know that. We know that, for example, between the Delta wave and the Omicron wave, between October and November last year, for example, when we had just a bit of a breather, that alone allowed, for example, scheduled operations to increase by around about 23-odd% in the space of a month. So we know that the NHS has the ability to recover if we can somehow insulate it from the worst impacts of COVID-19. So I certainly agree with that point. And staffing is key to that, and I won't rehearse in too much detail the good record I think we've got on staffing. That isn't to say there aren't vacancies. We know that there are, but under this government, over 28,000 additional whole time equivalents in our NHS is, I would say, an impressive record in terms of staffing. I suppose the third point I would make in relation to the issue at hand is that is why we are investing heavily in the multidisciplinary team model. Because if we think about it, you know, somebody who has been waiting for an operation, unfortunately due to the pandemic, that has been postponed, actually going to see the physio based in your GP practice could be of more value to you, or be of, you know, real importance and value to you, and at the same time frees up the GP, as we say, to be those expert medical generalists to deal with more complex cases. So I think the points Stephanie Callaghan makes are well made and are really important, and that's why the recovery of the NHS is so vital.
Thanks, Convener. Thank you for that. So good to hear you mention multidisciplinary teams, and it's great that they're really expanding as well. I mean, we've now got physios, pharmacists, OTs, mental health nurses, as well as dentists, optometrists, pharmacists, psychiatrists, paramedics. So getting bigger and bigger and expanding all the time, and I think that's really important. But what we're hearing in previous evidence as well around the workforce planning is some concerns that what we're going to end up doing is really moving people around rather than creating that new capacity that we need there. And how important it is for investment in planning and integrating primary care across the workforce and right across services there. So how will the Scottish Government look at creating that new capacity in planning and implementing primary care workforce and services right across the board? Thanks.
Yeah, again, I mean, there's little in there that you've said that I would disagree with. I think there's been it's a valid concern, and one that we've always had, is that we're not just creating these multidisciplinary teams and taking them from other services and in the community. So I think it's a valid concern, particularly given the impact the pandemic has had on being able to attract staff from outside of Scotland too. So for this specific programme, these concerns surfaced in early years of reform, but in recent years they've levelled off. We're confident that there's genuine additional capacity in primary care, complementing existing teams. What we're seeing with recruitment of MDTs is a much greater emphasis on training, a much greater emphasis on kind of quote unquote growing your own. Pharmacotherapy is a good example of that, where plans in year one and two, I mean, they were very kind of pharmacist heavy, if I can put it that way. Recently, the skill mix is moving more towards the use of pharmacy technicians, with a projected 75 pharmacy technicians in post for every 100 pharmacists in 2023, that compared to 29 for every 1,000 pharmacists. So training a pharmacy technician, for reference, takes about 2 years, considerably less than a pharmacist. So I think ensuring that we have that pipeline for the future is really important, so we don't just end up in a sense cannibalising the workforce that is already out there. I'm really keen to attract a lot of the workforce from other parts of the UK. and in fact the common travel area, as well as overseas, putting a lot of emphasis on international recruitment. I was really pleased actually to see some of our international nurse recruits in NHS Fife recently, and that was in hospital and acute site and secondary care. But equally, I think there's a role there for primary care too.
And just a final question, convener. Thank you. I'm wondering if you want to comment, a nice short question, but I'm not sure it'll be a nice short answer, but I'm wondering if you could comment on what the implications of the National Care Service may be on workforce capacity and planning.
Well, I'll try to be brief in the sense that it's an issue that's definitely gathered a fair bit of attention. And again, when I talk about my conversations with the RCGP and the BMA, it'll not be a surprise to anybody, or I don't think I'd be articulating a state secret if I say that they've got some concerns around some of the consultation proposals around moving GPs from their current employment model into potentially being employed as part of the National Care Service. And we're yet to come to determination on that, but I will say at this stage that I think they make quite persuasive and strong arguments for retention of the current employment model, but let's see when it comes to National Care Service how we're truly integrating primary care as part of the National Care Service, and we've got to do that. I mean, integration has got to be key, and with the reformed IGB's proposal, again, I'll be careful what I say because we're still going through the consultation responses, but we would hope that there is that real integration from inception, from the creation of the National Care Service, with, for example, health boards, and that's going to be really vital. So we're considering those consultation responses. Got to be a bit careful because we're hurtling into pre-election period. So my desire would be to pick up the conversations with COSLA in particular in earnest post the elections at very quick speed. Come to Parliament, I would hope, with the legislation being introduced before we go into summer recess for the National Care Service. And of course, we look forward to being able to articulate what our vision is for the National Care Service in that period.
Very helpful, thanks.
We've got some questions on workforce and capacity from Sue Weber.
Thanks, Convener, and hello, Cabinet Secretary. Thanks for coming this morning. Recruitment and retention within general practice continues, as you know, to be a critical issue as we recover from the pandemic. But even before COVID, the Audit Scotland reports were showing that the Scottish Government's plans to increase the GP workforce by 800 by 2027 is on course to be all but wiped out by the number of doctors expected to retire or change their working patterns. So what needs to happen to improve retention amongst general practitioners?
Yeah, I think it's a great question, because you're absolutely right, because you can recruit and be as ambitious in the recruitment side, but if you're not retaining, then actually, you know, where is the value in that? So I hear a number of things from our general practitioners and those that work as part of a GP team, and it goes back to some of what the convener was saying. I think if we can ensure that the workload, well, the burden is eased and spread out across those multidisciplinary teams, I think that absolutely helps, because I don't think I'd, again, be surprised, giving away any surprises when I speak to GPs, they tell me that they're exhausted. The second thing I think we need to ensure we do is remove any potential disincentives. The BMA, for example, have asked me to look at whether or not there's anything we can do in around the pension side of things. I've written to the UK government around that, but also I'm looking to see what the Scottish government may be able to do in terms of potential schemes in relation to pensions. I haven't come to a firm conclusion on that yet, but I'm looking with an open mind. I think we also we need to continue to make progress with the current contract and, of course, the next phase of that contract, which, again, I would hope would make becoming a GP not just an attractive proposition, but staying within staying in that profession would be attractive. So I think there's a lot we probably can do that we're working on. I think there's more we can do that I'm giving active consideration to. But I think the points Sue Weber makes are absolutely right. You've got to focus on retention as much as you're focusing on recruitment.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for that answer. Thank you, Convener. One other question. Can you maybe help and explain what assessment that you have made with your team for the provision of the GP out of hours services during the pandemic?
Yeah, I mean, we keep this under regular review, as you'd imagine. Again, it would be fair to say there's been some challenge in that. And I know, for example, recently there's been a focus on a number of health boards and out-of-hours services, Lanarkshire, Forth Valley, perhaps being the ones that have been most recent. So we're continuing to keep this under review. There has been challenge throughout the course of the pandemic. My hope is as that pressure eases, and we're still in a very tricky position at the moment. But as that pressure eases, how do we make those out of hours options more attractive and sustainable? Mm-hmm. Because we know that people need that out of hour access. In fact, if we look at just the demand on NHS 24, and as an example of that, the demand for NHS 24 services has been through the roof in recent months and even the last couple of years. So I keep that under regular review, but I also recognise there's been some challenge in that regard.
Thank you. Thanks, Gavin.
I have a number of colleagues wanting to come in on workforce issues. I'll come to Paul Kane first of all.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Cabinet Secretary. I wonder if, just following on from some of those questions, my points are just about the data that's available. The figures by Public Health Scotland have showed that the number of whole-time equivalent GPs has actually gone down. I think we're at the lowest level now since 2013. So I think whilst the headcount is going up, I think whole-time equivalent is often a better yardstick in terms of understanding the picture of service across the country. We haven't had figures on whole-time equivalents in GPs, I think, since 2019. So I don't know if the Cabinet Secretary has information available, but I think the committee would be keen to see that information about where we are in terms of whole-time equivalent GPs. So I don't know if you can make a commitment to maybe provide that information.
Yes, if that information is able to be published and is not management information, and even if it is, let me see if find a way of making sure that we are able to publish that and is quality assured. I'm happy to write to the convener who will then pass that information on. But Paul O'Kane knows our commitments to additional headcount. He's right to make that difference, of course. But it's a significant target. But I go back to the points I made to Sue Webber and others have raised that that is just one part of the strategy for making sure that we have a sustainable GP service in primary care in the future. Retention is going to be a key part of that too.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that commitment.
Thank you. Emma Harper, you have a question on this?
Yep, thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Just, it comes to me to think about like recruitment of GPs. The ScotGem programme was created, and it's unique to Scotland, with a collaboration between St Andrews and Dundee to support training GPs. I'm assuming it's going well. I just wondered, it might take a longer answer than we can do here today, but just a wee update on how ScotGem's going.
It's going well. It is going well. And I'm probably, for the sake of brevity, better writing to you with more detail. It's a programme that actually we're continually looking to see how we can expand. How can we increase the capacity of the ScotGem programme because of the value of it that we've seen even in the early years of it. So I'm happy to provide, again, through the convener, perhaps in my written response, because there'll be a number of things I suspect I'll want to come back on if I just give you some more detailed data around how that programme is going. But, I mean, there's not a conversation I have with my primary care team around GP services where ScotGem isn't seen as a critical component of that.
And it has a particular focus on rural general practice.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that is really the primary focus of that work. There's some real issues around rurality, and not that I need to explain to Emma Harper, around GP recruitment and retention. ScotGem, I think, is an absolute vital part of that. I think some of the work that we're taking forward after Sir Lewis Ritchie's report, in fact, I just spoke to him last week about that work, is going to be vital for sustainability. So absolutely key to the rural challenges that we still continue to face in GP practices and in primary care more generally.
Joining us online on workforce, Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you, Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, good to have you here. My question is just going to come back onto one of the things you spoke about when it came to pensions. So if you look at Wales, and they have solved the issue of doctors paying to go to work through pensions by the recycling of the employer's contribution, which then allows the doctors that are in danger of paying to go to work to actually not do that and come out of the scheme for that. But it's a fairly good solution because it brings in more taxation as well, because that money is then taxed. So my question would be really why we have not gone down that route quicker, because it does seem to be working in another devolved area.
Yeah, and you know, again, the position, as I understand it, also in England, is that NHS trusts are able to bring forward a REC scheme. So you're right to point out that in England and Wales that option exists. It's why I'm very actively considering it. I suppose I've got to think carefully about also the financial impact on for the Scottish Government for a group of clinicians who work incredibly hard, but I think we'd all accept they're at the higher end of the pay scale. And if we are to do that, then what about those at the lower end of the pay scale, and how do we ensure that they are that we are either removing disincentives but also putting our money and our resources towards those who are at that lower end of the pay scale, which I think is the progressive thing to do. So I certainly haven't ruling out a REC scheme and introducing one. In fact, far from ruling it out, I'm doing the opposite. I'm very actively considering it, and as I would say, I'd expect to be able to say something more on that in the coming months, but it shouldn't be more than that. And we're in the middle of discussions around pay for agenda for change staff, but also, of course, waiting for recommendations also from the DDRB as well. So we're in a really important juncture when it comes to discussions around pay, about terms, conditions, but the REC scheme is being absolutely actively considered, and discussions with the Welsh Government and indeed the UK Government on the REC scheme and the effect of it, those discussions are ongoing.
Thank you. We now move on. Evelyn Tweed has got some more in-depth questions on signposting and joins us online. Evelyn?
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the Cabinet Secretary and panel. The Cabinet Secretary had mentioned the key role of receptionists and the role that they have to play in primary care reforms, and often that the receptionist can be seen as a barrier rather than a facility. What would the Cabinet Secretary have to say on how we can improve interactions between patients and receptionists? And you also raised the point about raising the profile of receptionists.
Yeah. I suppose I would just refer to my earlier comments that we, first of all, abhor any abuse to any staff. I mean, it's unacceptable, and we know our receptionists are, you know, a vital component of that GP team and that primary care team. So any abuse they're suffering is just unacceptable. We've heard evidence of that from a number of different sources. So that's why the big messaging campaign in primary care at the moment is focusing on the role of receptionists. We launched it on the 3rd of March earlier this month. It was a reception awareness campaign, raising campaign across Scotland. It's aimed at the general public, and it's raising awareness of the important role that receptionists play. And if anybody hasn't seen the advert, again, who's sitting around this table, I would commend it to you. We're happy to, again, perhaps in the response to the convener, send you a link across to the video that is playing out there. It's an excellent advert and really shows the various different pathways that are available, and that receptionists are trying their best to be helpful. They're not trying to be blockers, they're not trying to be gatekeepers, they're not trying to be difficult. What they're actually doing is caring for the person on the other side of the telephone while they are under significant pressure themselves, and say, well, actually, we think the best route for you is X, Y, Z. So I think that's part of it. I think messaging is definitely part of it. I suppose my appeal to people would would be that, notwithstanding, I know how difficult it can be, how frustrating I can imagine it can be, also given the demand that is on the service, you're maybe not being seen straight away, or you're not getting a consultation straight away, that it can feel like you're being fobbed off, but that is not not what GPs are doing, not what receptionists are doing either. We do have a short life working group that focuses on the role of receptionists. They're going to meet again. That short life working group was a number of years ago. We're going to restart it again to meet for the first time since the pandemic in April. The group, chaired by Fiona Duff, senior advisor to the primary care directorate, will focus on development, but also the future needs of GP practice managers and some of the admin staff as well. So I think we can pick up some of this in that working group. What is the future role of our receptionists in this work?
Evelyn.
Thanks, Convener. And how can it be ensured that in promoting alternative pathways to primary care, that patients consistently access the most appropriate care for their needs? And what safeguards will be in place, Secretary?
I suppose for me, it is about ensuring that we are investing in those multidisciplinary teams. I have every trust that the clinical advice that a person will receive will mean that they will get the best care possible. So, for example, if they were signposted towards the physio, but actually the physio, you know, will be so interconnected as part of that multidisciplinary team, and will say, actually, perhaps the best thing for you is going to see the pharmacist, because potentially the mixture of medicines that you're taking, there's a particular side effect that is causing the issue that I'm looking at here, that they're then passed on to the pharmacist, who's then able to perhaps provide different medicines or a combination of different medicines that will help with the pain that they're feeling. Now, we've got to trust in that clinical judgment. I certainly do, and we've got to, I think, collectively trust in that clinical judgment. Where things go wrong in the few instances where they do, and we have to acknowledge that that can be the case, then there are obviously avenues to pursue those complaints and so on and so forth. But I would hope in the vast majority of cases that because clinicians are working as part of that multidisciplinary but also multi-agency approach, I would hope that most people, of course, the vast overwhelming majority of people, will get the right care at the right place at the right time.
Evelyn?
That's me.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So you have a supplementary question on this issue.
Thanks, Convener. Yes, Cabinet Secretary. It's following on what Evelyn was saying, asking about the role of the receptionist. And we hear in some of the papers there's gatekeeper, but they're called signpost and gateway. I think it's that positive versus negative language. But still, the people accessing all these MDTs have to contact that individual. And that is still very much often the bottleneck that causes the frustration. So I'm just wondering what your thoughts are about how we might look to overcome that.
Yeah, again, I think it's a really good question. So I think there's a few things we can do, but if I try to keep it brief, one is we are investing in telephony systems. So we provided, I think it's around about £2 million to health boards to improve those telephony systems. But actually, this may be something that we perhaps cover in more detail later on, I don't know, but digital access to health services through digital means, I think, is hugely important to that. And that's why, again, as part of our digital health and care strategy, we talk about the digital front door, so that actually there's maybe less reliance in the future on having to pick up the phone and, you know, having to phone at 8 a.m, for example, and all having to rush and then you've got to hit redial 16 times and then you possibly get an appointment or not. Mm-hmm. That's frustrating for everybody. It's frustrating for the reception, I suspect, at 7:59, feeling quite anxious.
Yeah, exactly.
And it's pretty frustrating, I suspect, for the individuals on the other side of that call. So I think digital has a real role to play in that too.
Thank you.
Paul, you have a question on this?
Thank you, Convener. I think just following on from that point, and I think a lot of the staff in practices aren't just receptionists. I think we know that. We've heard about signposting and gatekeeping and all those sorts of things. I mean, we had some good evidence, I think, from Dr. Graham Marshall, who talked about training for reception teams and doing training with both clinical staff and the more administrative staff. I'm just wondering if there is opportunity that you see to perhaps standardise some of that training. And also, I think you know, it's hard because of the nature of GP practices, but to probably look at paying conditions in terms of that more administrative side, and how do we enhance the roles that are there? Because we know that, as I say, they're doing more than just answering the phone and talking to patients.
Yeah, I mean, I would agree with all those points. So that's why the discussions that we have with the BMA and the Royal College of GPs is really collaborative, because given the model of obviously the independent contractor model that we have, really important that we keep close to our GP colleagues just on in relation to those terms and conditions, as you rightly reference. I just go back, the only thing I would say is I just go back to my answer about the Short Life Working Group, which is a meeting again next month. And they are looking at those very issues that Paul O'Kane references around administration, development, training, and I think those are very key points. I think the difficulty absolutely is that question of kind of standardising right across the country, and that has its benefits for sure. Also has its disadvantages in terms of flexibility for more rural, remote areas. But look, I don't disagree with the substantive points that Paul O'Kane makes.
Thank you. We're going to move on to talk about social prescribing and questions led by Sue Webber.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, one third of the respondents to the committee's public survey said that their experience of social prescribing was either bad or very bad, while some respondents said they would be insulted if directed to these services. A common theme in particular amongst respondents was that they could have found the same or better information elsewhere. So you get a sense that there's a bit of frustration there. So what needs to happen to make these pathways perceived and indeed more valuable and more credible to the public?
Yeah, again, it's a really good question. So that was about a third. So I don't know, I'll need to look at the survey, but I'm hoping that means that the majority of people found it quite helpful in terms of a pathway for that. But that third is still significant. It's not an insignificant number of people. So I think a few things need to be done. I think we need to be able to extol the virtues collectively of social prescribing. I'm a real believer in the ability of social prescribing to play a positive impact for people, because I've seen it, you could say, first-hand, second-hand, certainly in my own personal experiences. I see it in a constituency MSP level. I've got a fantastic community link worker in Pollock, and she's just taken over from an equally fantastic community link worker at the health centre in Pollock. So I'm certainly, in some sense, an evangelist for this. I would also say that consistency... So messaging is absolutely needed and key, and so there's maybe something here for government to think about, given what you said, about how do we, again, articulate the virtues of social prescribing. Because it's not just about signposting people to, look, here's XYZ, service in your local community. It's about that link worker building up a relationship with that individual and saying, look, this is how I think it could really support you, and really taking them on that journey with them. So I think that's key. There is something about consistency across the country. I think that's a fair point. So we've commissioned Voluntary Health Scotland to develop a national network of community link workers where they can share that best practice, be peer-to-peer support for each other as well. But how do they share that knowledge across the country? So they're undertaking, a review of support and training needs of link workers, and we'll build on the findings of that review as well. So I think there's a lot to do in this space, but I would hope that most people that experience and have an interaction with a community link worker, I think for most people, I would hope it would be a very positive experience.
Thank you. And following on from that, the hope that they are having that good experience, Healthcare Improvement Scotland also highlighted in their response to our consultation that the increase of social prescribing is dependent on continuous monitoring. So are you aware of the monitoring that is currently being undertaken? And if so, how extensive is it?
Yeah, I think, again, that's probably something, without prejudging the review, that will come through, is that we tend to try to leave, in some respects, this to local, the community link workers and the way that they work, how they interact with the third sector, how they interact with community groups. We generally leave that to the expertise of the community link worker plus the general practice that they work in, and the other members of the multidisciplinary team that they work with. So there's not that kind of standardised, one-size-fits-all, top-down approach. Here's what we think you should do, here's how we think you should do it, etc. Because we've got to have that local flexibility. What works for a community link worker in my patch and in my constituency in Pollock isn't necessarily going to work for a community link worker in Peebles, for example, or Perthshire, or whatever P you want to use that is different to Pollock. So, you know, it is clearly important that we retain that local flexibility. I think what we're hearing back from people is, well, how do you, and this is a key to your central to your question as well, how do you then monitor the impact that they're having? So I think there's probably a bit of work for us to do nationally around monitoring that impact in perhaps greater detail.
That's great. Thanks very much, Convener.
Thank you. And Gillian Mackay, you have some questions around social prescribing.
Thanks, Convener. More Secretary. Witnesses to the committee have highlighted that a culture change is needed with regards to social prescribing, as many patients are still not comfortable with the idea of it. Some organisations have heard that people felt shortchanged when they were redirected to links practitioners rather than a GP. And GPs have also highlighted time constraints limit their ability to explain social prescribing to patients. What action is being taken at a national level to facilitate this and to promote and explain social prescribing and its benefits to the public?
Yeah, I think I'll try not to repeat what I said before in too much detail at all, but I think we have done marketing kind of communications around social prescribing. I think we probably want to up the ante on that, particularly given the effects that the pandemic has had on people's mental health in particular. I think there's a real role for social prescribing, to play in those mental health challenges and overcoming some of those mental health, or helping to overcome some of those mental health challenges. So I think there's a need for us to re-energise some of the national communication around this. I would hope that, again, through the measures we've taken in terms of expanding the MDTs, that as that eases the workload on the kind of workload pressures on GPs, that they have that time to be able to explain to an individual, actually, this is not about, again, being fobbed off or passed on. You know, there is real value in what the community links worker can do, and having them embedded as part of that team, I think, is really valuable. So I do think there's work for us to do in that, but I do believe it's the right way to go. It's why we've obviously committed to 1,000 mental wellbeing, mental health workers and GP practices in the future, because, again, we think there's real value to those individuals connecting with services in the community. So more to do in that, and perhaps we've got to think a little bit more about national messaging around the value of social prescribing.
That's great. Thanks, Camilla.
Thank you, Gillian. And we'll now move on to questions from Emma Harper. Emma.
Thanks, Convener. I am very interested in social prescribing as well, and but it's about how do we signpost folk to some of the services that are out there. And during this inquiry, we have focused on additional third sector services and helping people signpost them to using ALICE, which is the government-funded local information system. And then I know we heard last time about Evoke, which is an Edinburgh-based one, and then one in Dumfries and Galloway called DG Locator. So I'm interested to hear from your Cabinet Secretary about what can we do to help enhance the ALICE system so that we can better support it, or look at how we can direct people to mental health services, for instance, because we have seen the benefits of men's sheds, walking football, walking groups, and just, you know, social groups as well, which third sector can help direct people to. So how can we help support ALICE in order to help signpost people?
Yeah, I think it's a good point about ALICE. I think it came across quite clearly from the evidence sessions. I didn't get to see it, but I was reading about the evidence sessions that you were taking, that ALICE was seen as an important tool, or certainly had the potential to be a really important tool, but it was felt that it wasn't currently updated enough. The functionality could be better. So I think all that feedback that we heard from your committee evidence sessions is really helpful to us. Alice is a great resource, has over 5,500 services available from over 800 organisations, so it's got a significant amount of detail. It was searched over 26,000 times in the space of the 3 months, October to December last year as well. But we recognise it needs some work done to it because it is an important tool. So some of that work is actually being done at the moment. Work to enhance the performance and accessibility of Alice is being undertaken by the Alliance, and we're hoping that work finishes in the summer of this year.
Okay, that's good to hear. And you know, like, I'm thinking about also the way that we direct people. For instance, we've heard in some of the feedback that if people will go and see their GP and expect a tablet for their diabetes, for instance, when maybe a social prescribing programme will help actually reverse type 2 diabetes. And we saw that with the Fixing Dad programme where Jeff Whittington lost, I know he was 20 stone and he lost so much weight. And that was part of helping support that family, and they managed to help their dad lose a lot of weight. I'm just wondering what else that we should be able to do to help show people that these alternative pathways are actually adjuncts and not necessarily standard B instead of class A out of the whole process. I mean, we have seen, especially during the COVID pandemic, how important it is to support people's mental health and actually get them outside and walking, for instance.
Yeah. Look, I don't think there's a kind of magic wand or silver bullet to all of this. I think communication is certainly part of it. I think people will see the value, and the more and more people that we can get access to social prescribing and give them access to social prescribing, then I think they will see the value of it themselves as individuals. I think they will hopefully then, through word of mouth, tell other people about the benefits of it. I think we will do clearly what we can, and I've referenced in just a previous answer a moment ago that perhaps there is a role for more national type messaging, maybe linking in with the third sector around some of that. But I do think that actually experiencing the benefits, just as you've very articulately put across from your own constituent, if people hear those stories, and maybe there's something to do around the case examples, then I think that will speak volumes in comparison to necessarily a government kind of marketing campaign. So I think those stories, those personal experiences are hugely important to all of this. And people will see, I mean, expansion, I mentioned our increase of kind of mental health workers, which could absolutely include community link workers, but it could be even broader than that. I think as we see more and more of those individuals embedded within the GP's practice, then more and more people will clearly have access to them and hopefully benefit from them and speak to others about the positive impact it had in their lives.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Thanks.
Thanks, Emma. We now move on to talking about digital health and care. Questions led by Paul O'Kane. Paul.
Thank you, convener. We've heard evidence from patient groups, particularly the Riverside Patient Participation Group, who I think are Musselburgh, and they've spoken about digital exclusion and health needs, and I think those two things coinciding. So we understand that approximately 10% of the population doesn't have access to or the skills required to use new technology. And those patients are most likely to have the greatest health needs. There's a clear kind of correlation there. So I'd be keen just to get the Cabinet Secretary's sense of how can their route into primary care be protected and enhanced, given the challenges?
Yeah, so something we're really conscious of and really aware of. And again, if you haven't read the report that was published from the Short Life Working Group, the expert working group on primary care and health inequalities, I would definitely recommend it to you. You may well have done so already, but if you haven't, because I know how busy we all are, it's certainly worth just taking a bit of time to go through that. And again, the points around digital exclusion are well made by the likes of Again, somebody who's involved in that working group, Dr. Carrie Lunan, who is part of the Deep End project, which again I know committee members are very aware of. So those 100 GP practices that are in our most deprived areas often talk to us about digital exclusion. So a couple of things. One is that anything we do in the digital space, we have to ensure that, one, we're not just aware and acknowledging digital exclusion, but we're assuring there's an alternative pathway for people that just do not have access, no matter how hard we may try. There will be some people who just either will not feel comfortable or will not feel able to use those particular digital routes, and therefore we have to ensure those alternative pathways are still available for them. The other thing we should do, and we are doing, of course, is trying to really focus in on that digital inclusion piece. And you know, this is where I, you can imagine, work closely with colleagues right across government, because this is an agenda that is important to many cabinet secretaries, all cabinet secretaries and ministers. So the Connecting Scotland programme aims to support an additional 300,000 households to get online. So let's connect as much of Scotland as possible, but let's also accept that even doing that, there will be some people whereby the alternative non-digital pathway will be important. So that's absolutely a part of our thinking moving forward.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, I think we've also had discussions, and I've been kind of banging on slightly about the need for, I think, you know, provision of digital spaces within our community locations. So libraries is the obvious one that comes to mind, and I've spoken about that before, about how do we, you know, utilise libraries and improve their services and protect their services so that people can access digital where they need to, and not necessarily, you know, in the public part of the library. I think there's definitely spaces where people can be supported to do that in communities. I think also part of the challenge can often be that in a lot of communities, the GP surgery is one of the few kind of amenities that there is. I'm thinking particularly in rural locations. So it becomes very much the hub and the focus. I'm just keen to understand, how do we do more of, because people might not want to get online on their own at home. That can be the challenge and that can be the barrier. So how do we ensure that there are more and more facilities available to people within community settings where they can actually access information online, advice online, or indeed consultation online as well?
Yeah, but again, there's nothing that I disagree with that Paul Kane has said there, and I think that's why investing in our public services locally is so important. So he references library, and I take again a library in my own community, and the constituency that I represent not only has the public space but has actually a quieter space for people to be able to go online if there's something particularly sensitive that they need to look at, with all the appropriate checks and safety balances that you, safety measures that you'd expect. I think it's a good point about whether or not we can explore if there's more that we can do within GP practices and health centres themselves. So probably easier to do in the larger kind of health centres that we have. How do we do it in smaller locations where space is already at a premium? But I think it's a really good point and one that I'll take away in the back of the comments Paul O'Kane has made.
Thank you, Kavina.
Paul, so you have some questions around this.
Oh, yeah, thank you very much. We spoke earlier about some of the potential changes that you're talking about, the telephony system for GPs. And the adoption of digital health and care information has really accelerated through the pandemic. You've seen that with the... but has the quality and the quantity of resources kept up with demand, and are relevant websites easy to navigate, and including those that are with only a limited digital understanding? So I'm trying to figure out, are we keeping up with the development needed? And I'm thinking back to an article that was in The Scotsman the other week about having an app that you could access your test results and your make appointments, etc., where we're sitting not with that available to us in Scotland, but NHS England has that app available now. And we're just wondering why there's not a bit more cross-border sharing in terms of that technology development as well.
Yeah, so a couple of things I would say on that front. One is, you know, there has been an explosion of interest in digital health and accessing health information digitally throughout the course of the pandemic, out of necessity, no doubt. But I would hope NHS Inform is a good example of a service that has been well used throughout the course of the pandemic. And perhaps in my response to the convener, written response to the convener, I can share with you some of the data behind how well NHS Inform has been used, as have other digital platforms. So near me again would be the obvious example, again the explosion in the use of that. I think the point that Sue Webber makes around the digital app is a really important one, so it's a manifesto commitment from us to develop that NHS app, that digital front door, so we're working on that. Where that requires discussion, not only requires, where it's sensible to have that discussion with other parts of the UK, we are doing and will do. I think there's no point in reinventing the wheel if there's something that works particularly well. There may be challenges, we may not just be able to, and I know you're not suggesting this, of course, but we may not just be able to kind of pluck the app from one part of the UK and just transplant it here. So certainly, that I mean, I have a really good relationship with the other health secretaries and ministers across the UK. So absolutely we can share that information, knowledge. I'd be keen to do that. So I think there's a lot of progress to be made in this area, and a potential digital front door app that can do a whole host of things, from booking appointments to receiving results, is really something. It's something we're very focused on.
In previous sessions, some of the officers, the government officials that work with that digital platform have stated there's a disconnect between the level of investment that we have in the people developing the technology compared to other parts of the UK. So do you have plans to upscale and have more people working behind the scenes to develop these?
Yeah, in short, yes. It's been the digital team will know this. I am constantly speaking to them about
the
need.
This is what
happens all the time. Oh, right, okay. It's certainly an area. I mean, the team hear from me regularly that I say that more investment, more resources will come their way as a digital team, and it's something I'm committed to doing because it needs beefed up, that current digital team. They're a great team. They do a heck of a lot, and blooming heck, they've worked really hard throughout the course of the pandemic. But I definitely think that there's value in up. Not just upskilling, but actually increasing just the numbers in that team. I think the second thing I would say is I've also said the same to our health board chief execs and chairs. In fact, I said it to them just yesterday when we had a session, which was, you know, we understandably put a lot of focus when we talk about infrastructure on bricks and mortar. It's important to build health centres, hospitals, community services. But we should be, I think, putting equally as much focus on when we talk about infrastructure, on digital infrastructure and the need to invest in that. So certainly in that discussion yesterday, there was lots of broad agreement on that. So in short, the answer to your question is yes, the digital team in government is going to be an appropriate resource, and that resource is undoubtedly going to have to increase to meet our ambitions.
Thank you.
Following on from that, you mentioned near me. I was going to ask you about near me and an assessment of one of those things in the pandemic, one of those very few things in the pandemic that actually might be a positive that's come out of it, that perhaps that face-to-face, that video conferencing aspect of healthcare for some people has actually been really helpful and possibly something that they would want to opt for in the future. And the word opt is important here.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Is there going to be an assessment of some of the learning that's come out of the pandemic in terms of digital healthcare and things we maybe want to keep, mm-hmm. and maybe further investment in it?
Yeah. Again, I agree entirely with your articulation of it, that it should be part of a hybrid model. A telephone consultation, video consultation, face-to-face consultation, that's all part of that hybrid model. And, of course, for people that should be seen, even now with the current pressures, people that should be seen face-to-face, that should be happening. If that's not happening, then I'm not happy about that. But I certainly know that in the future, as we look towards that hybrid model, for many people, continuing with video or telephone consultation will be their preferred option, and there's a preferred option for me. I've used it during the pandemic. It wasn't necessarily the most comfortable experience trying to show the back of my knee when I have some eczema to the doctor, but we got there and we got the it worked well, and within you know, that was in the morning, or by the afternoon I had the ointment that I needed at the pharmacy down the road, and it saved me the journey, taking time out of quite important meetings to travel to the GP, wait in the waiting room, get assessed. So for me it worked perfectly, and there'll be many people who have work pressures, family pressures, you know, and so on, where it's just far more convenient to be seen over video or indeed a telephone consultation. What I would say is that I suppose it goes back in some respects to Paul O'Kane's point about digital inclusion, stroke exclusion. Got to be really careful that those people who are digitally excluded will get them digitally included as best as possible, but accepting that that won't be the case for everybody, those alternative pathways have to be available. So nobody is talking about, you know, removing the need for face-to-face appointments, and certainly not a single GP advert has ever suggested that. So we want to work collaboratively with GPs on this, and probably just worth me stating for the record that, you know, I think it's been quite upsetting to see some of the kind of finger-pointing and almost blaming towards some elements of primary care, GPs included, from, again, some sections of the public discourse, press, political. I just think it's undervaluing a really important contribution that GPs and GP staff in their entirety have made. So, you know, just to put on record that I'm really thankful for their efforts. I also understand the frustration, some people trying desperately to get an appointment and not being able to. You know, this is the challenge that the pandemic has brought to us. But I don't doubt that as we ease our way out of the pandemic, or certainly into a more endemic phase, that things will certainly, access to primary care will certainly improve.
Emma, you have a quick question on this.
Yep, thanks, Convener. I mentioned rural earlier, and we're talking about digital inclusivity or exclusion. We've found that people have been able to have telephone calls or video calls, or even see their for mental health consultations in rural areas using the digital access. So is that something that we will continue to be measuring to see how, you know, how that benefits people? So rurally, you do get to see somebody. And yes, we still have the ability to see face to face, because that might be the absolute best way forward for some people. But for our rural areas, that it could be quite positive to continue to use Near Me, for instance.
Yeah, absolutely. Again, I think there's little for me to add, because Emma Harper's articulated it well. I think there's a continued role for the hybrid model, but there is a maybe particular importance in areas of rurality and also island communities as well. And that goes back to the point I made earlier. We've got to ensure, as the government is doing, that there is good digital coverage right across the entire country. And we know that can be particularly important in remote, rural and island communities as well, but our investment, I think, speaks for itself in that respect. You know, I have little to add other than to agree with Emma Harper's assessment.
Thank you. We're going to now move on to talk about the single electronic patient record, which come up frequently in our other sessions, and questions led by Stephanie Callaghan.
Thanks very much, Convener. A couple of weeks ago, we got some really very strong evidence about the importance of the electronic single patient record, the need for that easy, seamless and secure access to shared health and care records at the point of care, and how this will improve continuity of care and will also ease frustration for patients and workers. Then last week in the evidence, we heard from some of the digital professionals, and there certainly seems to have been some good progress on a central cloud-based platform that allows different systems to talk to each other. There were also mentions of pilots in the data strategy engagement programmes. So I'm wondering, are you able to provide us with a bit more information on the kind of positive progress that we've got towards a national digital platform, and commit to keeping us updated on this work going forward in the committee? Thanks.
Yeah, I can be relatively brief in that, you know, all of the points you've made are clearly ones that are a priority for us. I think there's a real recognition here that the sharing of information, of data, is absolutely crucial to make sure people aren't passed from pillar to post, as Sue Webber had made the point earlier on. What I would say is that what is really important, and it's in our digital health. Actually, I was just double-checking the detail of it, but it's really clear there in the strategy about that cloud-based architecture and how important that could be. And again, I would commend the strategy for anybody to see if they haven't seen it. So the National Digital Platform, detail of that is on page 18 of that strategy. Again, it's not about necessarily just a single product. You don't need to have a single product, and that could take a lot of time and considerable investment. But actually, that integrated approach to those cloud-based digital components and capabilities, that's what's going to play a real important and significant role in that data sharing that Stephanie Callaghan talks about. So, yes, investment has been made, will continue to have to be made, because it is not without a financial implication here. But some of that rollout, some of that work is already very much underway. But I think it's incumbent on us in government, and certainly in my role, to accelerate that, given the challenges the pandemic has brought and will continue to, I'm afraid, have on our health service for many years to come.
Okay. Thanks. I know a few of my colleagues have got questions.
Thank you very much. Thanks for that, Stephanie. Sandesh Gohani has a question on this specifically from online. Sandesh.
Thank you, convener. Cabinet Secretary, as you said just there, data is absolutely vital. As a GP, I can't see what my psychiatric colleagues have written. When I was doing my psychiatric block, I couldn't see what the CAMS doctors had written, and I was yet covering the CAM service overnight. We've got patients who have to tell their story on repeated occasions and out of hours, though we have KISS service, is unable to see what was written by myself, and I'm unable to see what the out of hours have written. So all in all, the sharing of information in a patient's journey is not adequate at the moment. And I think this is a real safety concern. Now, what can we do quickly to try and solve this? And secondly, when we do get data sharing, what is the implications and the data protection implications that arise through this?
Look, I think they're both good questions. And look, I would defer to your to Dr. Gohani's expertise in this regard, and he speaks from a professional experience, and I think he's articulated well where some of those, as he put it rightly, I think, safety concerns are when it comes to the sharing of data, because we can talk about data as though often there's not a person behind it. There very much is a person behind it, and potential implications for that individual. So again, I will commend to him the national the work, sorry, in the digital health and care strategy. It says and outlines very clearly what our actions are, and how we're undertaking them with pace, I would say. So the national digital platform work is very much underway. It's under new leadership within NHS National Education for Scotland, and it's very much we're very much investing in it. It would be wrong for me to say that it's going to be done overnight or in a matter of weeks. There are some really complex digital IT solutions that have to be found in this work as it develops. But that goes back to the point I made to Sue Webber. That's why the investment in government in that team is so important. In terms of the second part of your question, again, I think it's a really important point to make. We all are aware of the importance of ensuring that we safeguard this information, very sensitive health information, and it can be about people's mental health as much as their physical health. So as part of that digital strategy, again, you can see it quite clearly in that digital strategy, that one of the key pillars is to ensure that information governance is at the heart of that, including ensuring the right assessments are in place, ensuring that we do the appropriate assessments, so that's data protection impact assessments, equality impact assessments, as well. So at the heart of that strategy the confidentiality of patient medical records and ensuring that we live up to our responsibilities in terms of the sharing of that data is at the core and the root of everything we do. And again, as I say, it's a key component as part of that national care and health and care digital strategy.
Move on to a theme that has come up, as we expected, throughout the session, and indeed all of the sessions that we've had on this, and that's inequalities. And questions are led by Gillian Mackay. Gillian.
Thank you, Convener. In a previous meeting, I asked witnesses about the inverse care law and how, as the system becomes more complicated to navigate, with people expected to self-refer to different services, we mitigate the risk of those with lower levels of health literacy becoming less likely to engage with health services. They highlighted that targeted communication was vital, as well as detailed analysis of the data that's being collected on who is accessing different services directly instead of through GP referrals. What action is the Scottish Government taking on this, and what plans are there to collect and analyse this data?
Yeah, again, I think it's a really good question. So, again, I would commend, if you haven't, though you may have already seen this work, in terms of the Shortlink Working Group recommendations that were published, and key to that is data. And I think while the data collection that we have is relatively good, in the inequality space it can be far better. And key to that is developing services co-produced with those people that are being affected the most by those changes. So I think the work that we're doing with patient groups, but particularly in areas of deprivation where we know inequality is worse, there's clearly a need for us to develop those services with those individuals going forward. So I'm very keen that now that we have the working group's recommendations, we now have a development group that will take forward a number of those recommendations. That my instruction to that team is to make sure that we are co-producing the work that we do with those that are spearing those inequalities at the sharp end. And that is not to place an additional burden on those individuals. We've got enough to do, no doubt, as we all will do in our daily lives. But that qualitative data for us can be really important. So while we have robust, I would say, quantitative data, I think is that qualitative piece that can add some significant value.
We know that in urban areas there can sometimes be barriers to people having to attend different sites, to attend different appointments and things like that. Do you think that geographical variation in provision of alternative pathways could exacerbate inequalities, particularly in rural areas where some of those distance between appointments could be quite significant?
Yeah, so to hopefully give you as much reassurance as I possibly can, we are so aware of that point that anything we are doing, we're hoping to be able to mitigate some of those challenges. So, whether we need to look at, as part of the work we're doing in this regard, transport solutions, that's got to be a part of that conversation. The question that Emma Harper asked a moment ago, I think, is also pertinent to this. So as opposed to having people travel 50, 60, 70 plus miles in some parts of Scotland to a different service, can something be done remote? Through digital means in a way that currently isn't being delivered? And for those people that do have to end up travelling, whether that's in an urban landscape or indeed in a remote or rural landscape, really important that we're putting the solutions in place at inception, as opposed to having designed the service, gone, oh goodness, well, there's some challenges here, and then try to fix it thereafter. If it gives some level of assurance, it's absolutely a fundamental part of our thinking as we deliver these services moving forward.
Thank you, Peter. Thanks.
Carol, you have some questions on inequalities?
Yeah. Please, thank you. Great, thank you. I want to take the opportunity to really raise something that I think is extremely important, and that is, as we change pathways, we know that screening, particularly in women and young girls in deprived areas, is definitely needing looked at. There's a significant difference. And in screening, we can make outcomes so much different. So I wonder just if the Cabinet Secretary
prioritises screening or sees how that we make sure that screening is taken up in those groups, particularly as the pathways changed. One of the most important questions, I think, is does the Scottish Government health and equality proof all its policies and all its practices as we move through and make any changes within particularly primary care?
Yeah. But look, I first of all want to recognise how important an agenda this is for all of us, but I know it's one that Karen Walken has raised with regularity, both here in the committee but also in the chamber. As well, and the second thing I would say is absolutely we see. Well, first of all, we value the importance of screening. I mean, it saves lives, and has the ability to save lives right across a variety of different cancer types. Equally, let me recognise the point that Carol Mockin makes that we know that there are disparities between the uptake of screening for those in the least deprived areas versus those that are in the most deprived areas. And that's why a lot of our focus is going into how do we increase the uptake. So I had a recent discussion with those officials involved in the National Screening Programme about this very issue. And so how do we use, for example, our mobile units? And we have a number of them, like over 20 from memory, mobile screening units. How do we use those mobile units to get into those areas of higher deprivation? So that is some of the work that's being undertaken as we speak. Targeted communications goes back to actually the point Gillian Mackay made, her first question. How do we ensure that we have more targeted communication to, again, individuals and perhaps the areas of highest deprivation? And the third point is we're thinking about is how do we ensure that there is appropriate voices from those communities where uptake is lower? So ethnic minority communities would be an example. I know you've asked about those in deprivation. There's often intersectionalities here, but we know that, for example, in certain screening programmes, the uptake for ethnic minority women is lower than it is for their white Scottish counterparts. And therefore, how do we use voices from those minority communities as opposed to, for example, a middle-aged white male doctor who, of course, has great clinical expertise but might not be as impactful as, for example, again, a female doctor from an Asian background speaking about the importance of ensuring you go to your screening appointment. So a lot of effort and work going into this because we recognise the disparities that exist.
And just on sort of equality proofing policies and things like that, do you have a plan within the department
of that? We have well established plans, obviously, as you know, in terms of an equality impact assessment, and so again, anything, any policy of significance, we would absolutely test that within the equality impact assessment. I think if I can give you some level of assurance when it comes to our health policies and initiatives that we take forward, I've not in the 10 odd months that I've been health secretary had a discussion about initiatives that were taking forward that hasn't included some sort of discussion about inequality at the heart of it and at the root of it, because the figures are stark, they do speak for themselves, and therefore a concerted effort in all areas, not just screening, in all areas of health policy absolutely has to be focused on driving down those inequalities. And that's why, for example, I can reference the work that the excellent Health Inequalities Primary Care team have just done that we just published earlier this month.
Thank you. Can I bring in Sue? Has got a question on this.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Yes, Cabinet Secretary, again, we know that screening saves lives and we know that early detection saves lives. I have a lady that's contacted me. She's over 70 and is desperate to get a breast screening. Due to some medication that she's on, there is a significant increase in risk of her getting breast cancer, yet she's been denied this. What can we do? I mean, she should be able to access equally treatment and screening that anyone else has, if specifically given the risk factor that has clearly been identified. How can we help this lady in particular?
So can I thank Sue Webber for what is a really important question, and I hope she will take my answer in the spirit that is intended, and I hope she will absolutely fundamentally choose to believe that the decisions we've taken about self-referral for those who are kind of 71 plus is not one that we take lightly. It's a really difficult decision to take, and I spoke to again those that are leading our screening programme, breast screening programme in particular, about this very issue just a couple of weeks ago, and the fundamental decision we have to arrive at here is that for the women that are the highest risk, so those that are 50 to 70 in that kind of age bracket, the period they are waiting between screens is at the moment too long. And there's no doubt that the pandemic has had an impact. We had to take a really difficult decision, as the member knows, at the beginning of the pandemic, to pause those screening programmes and then restart them in the summer of 2020. So because of the gap between screening programmes, which I think is around about 39 odd months, but just forgive me if that's incorrect, I'll correct it when I write to the convener. But at the moment, if we were to introduce the self-referral route for those that are 71 plus, then the estimate is that would add an additional 4 months onto the gap between screening cycles. Now, the question is, and this is the question I've asked officials to explore with PACE, is does the benefit of the over 70 referral route outweigh the additional few months that might be added on to the gap between screening that we have to accept will happen if we take that decision? So that work is underway, because I'm very aware that in other parts of the UK that self-referral route for older women does exist, mm-hmm. and is open. So it does look like there is a difference between the UK nations. But I am exploring it. I would hope to have an update in the relatively short future. But I am saying to officials that we need to just and I need a clinical view here. Mm-hmm. I'm not a clinician. I need a clinical view from those experts. If we were to increase the gap, what would be the significant, mm-hmm. would there be a significant impact? Or actually, is that outweighed by the benefit of the the older women receive?
I understand what you're saying. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. We have our final question from Sandesh Gohani. Sandesh?
Thank you, convener. I think we touched on this when we were talking about inequality not just being about wealth, and how rurality actually causes an inherent inequality. And it's clear that staffing issues are not evenly distributed around the country. And we just go back to link workers, the earlier Cabinet Secretary you were extolling of how good they are, and actually I love my link worker, I think they're absolutely brilliant. But they're not available to people in, say, Forth Valley or Aberdeenshire. And so at the heart of trying to have equality is ensuring that the staff who are available here in Glasgow or Edinburgh are available throughout the country. So how are you going to ensure that areas that are hard to recruit to, areas that don't have staff, will get the staff, and that will be rolled out in a manner which means going forwards, that will be at the heart of recruitment strategies?
Again, I think it's a really important question that's being asked. So first and foremost, where we can incentivise recruitment and retention in rural areas, we'll certainly do that. Emma Harper previously spoke about the ScotGem programme, which is an excellent example of that. Golden Hellos, in terms of bursaries that have been available, Rediscover the Joy programme. There's a number of different programmes I could point to where the focus is on rural recruitment retention. In terms of the community link workers and mental health workers, that's why our ambition is to have 1,000 of those individuals recruited by 2026 so that they're available in every single GP practice in the country. And again, if I can give some sort of assurance to Sandesh Gohani, it is that this element of rural provision and island provision is central to our thoughts in this respect.
Thank you. Thank you. Sorry, just to follow up on that, a golden hellos and trying to incentivise people to go to an area is important, because you need that incentivisation. But we're seeing a significant difference in pay when it comes to our colleagues. And we were hearing in previous evidence that sometimes they're band three, sometimes they're band four, and the amount that they would make. And obviously that will play a huge role. There's no point incentivising someone if they're going to make up significantly less money. So should we be standardising the level that, certainly at the start, that our allied health professionals start on, and then have those incentivisations to get them into those harder to recruit rural areas?
So I can absolutely see the argument being made. And again, Sandra Scohani articulates them well. My difficulty is that the mechanism is not the difficulty, because you can ultimately do that if there's a desire to do it. My difficulty is then when we talk about the 1,000 additional mental health workers, they could be various different workers. So it may be that a GP practice doesn't need an additional community link worker, but actually what they want is somebody specialising in particular mental health expertise, and therefore there may be different. Or workers with different specialities and different practices. So that's one thing we've got to be cognizant of. The second thing is that if we, in some respects, impose a national structure to this, then does that remove the flexibility that is required in various localities, including our island communities and rural communities? But is that a trade-off worth making? And the answer to that might well be yes, and therefore it's something, as I say, it's something we are exploring when we talk about the additional 1,000 that we've committed to. But I think we just have to be careful that we don't remove entirely the local flexibility. But I take the points that Dr. Gohani's making, and I can give him assurance it's all part of the thinking and the development, particularly of the 1,000 additional mental health workers that we've committed to.
Okay. Quite a question from Emma Harper. Emma, you want to come in?
Yep, thanks. Thanks, convener. It is just a quick supplementary question. I understand that community link workers will be required to do different duties depending on where they are, where they're working in a local authority or health board area. And according to an FOI that has been published on the government website, it says that there were 218 link workers in post at the end of March 2021. And I know there's been a pandemic for 2 years, and that's why some of this data, it might not be as up to date as we want, but it has a projected total by March 2022 of 323 link workers. So I'm just interested to hear the Cabinet Secretary's thoughts, again, to reinforce that link workers might be doing different things across different health boards, and we should support the health boards to know their own area and their own places to support their own GP practices, whether they're rural or urban.
Yeah, again, a lot of me to add, other than to say that's part of the reason why the 1,000 additional mental health workers we've committed to, we've kind of left it as broad as that, because for some areas, absolutely a community link worker with all, again, the different specialities that they will have might be important, but actually it may be more important for a GP practice to have a particular specialist, in a particular area of mental health, for example, focused on young people's mental health. So allowing that flexibility for a local area. And that's also why the relationship with the integration authorities at a local level is really important, as is the relationship with third sector. Yes, little for me to say other than I agree with Emma Harper's assessment that retaining that local flexibility is important. And I suppose, in answer to my previous question, that is the tension we've got to try to work through, because there are challenges around standardisation, and there are good arguments made for why that standardisation is necessary, but could that have a diminishing effect on the local flexibility? And I think that's an important discussion that is underway, and we need to continue.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for all your
your
answers this morning. We're going to, and thank you to your officials as well online. We're going to take a 10-minute break before we go into our next agenda item. Thank you.
Right, welcome back everyone. Our third item today is consideration of an affirmative instrument, and that's the Prohibition of Smoking Outside Hospital Buildings Scotland Regulations 2022. And we'll have an evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care and officials joining us online on the instrument. And once we've all our questions answered, we'll then have formal debate on the motion. I welcome who's continuing to stay with us in the committee, Hamza Youssef, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, and his accompanying Scottish Government officials are Claire McGill, Solicitor, and Jules Godlett-Rowley, Head of Healthy Living Unit, both from the Scottish Government. Thank you to you all for joining us. Cabinet Secretary, you have an opening statement.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks for letting me stay on to talk about these important regulations. And they, of course, at their heart, they set up no smoking perimeters around NHS hospital buildings. Hospitals, as we, I think, all can agree, should be places of health promotion where healthy ways of living are demonstrated and environments within which people are protected from harm and supported in making really positive lifestyle choices. Unfortunately, it's become commonplace to see patients, visitors and at times staff standing close to hospital buildings, entrances, smoking. This is despite an existing voluntary smoking ban on hospital grounds. Those entering and leaving buildings, some of whom are vulnerable and very unwell, may have to walk through smoke, and there's no means of reproaching those who ignore the request not to smoke. Our current Tobacco Action Plan, Raising Scotland's Tobacco-Free Generation, confirmed our intention to progress the work needed to introduce a mandatory ban on smoking near hospital buildings. This will support the existing voluntary ban and introduce fixed penalties and fines for those smoking near hospital buildings or allowing others to smoke there. But this effectively extends the successful 2004 indoor smoking ban on smoking in enclosed public spaces to an area outside the building. It will reduce the risk of exposure to secondhand smoke near entrances and windows. It will prevent smoke drifting into hospital buildings and ultimately protect those using hospitals, particularly our most vulnerable. Smoke from a single cigarette can be detected from at least 9 metres away. Weather conditions and wind speed can cause further drift. To account for that, a 15-metre distance is proposed. This focuses on the high traffic areas where people leave and enter the building. Just like the indoor smoking ban, these regulations are primarily about behaviour change to denormalise the act of smoking by making it socially unacceptable to smoke near hospital buildings. And it reinforces the NHS as an exemplar of health promotion. Smoking can be a hard habit to break, and people are advised to seek support. Anyone smoking in the perimeter could receive a fixed penalty notice of £50. If an individual is taken to court, they could be liable to a fine not exceeding £1,000. Those with management and control of the no smoking area have responsibility to ensure compliance. Should they knowingly permit someone to smoke, there could be a fine of up to £2,500. We will ask health boards and those with management and control of the area to work with local authorities and enforcement initiatives and agree and arrangements to ensure compliance. The Scottish Government will provide a signage for hospitals. We will prepare information. We'll also ensure everyone is aware of the change before it is introduced. Every year, tobacco use is associated with over 100,000 smoking attributable admissions and unfortunately 9,332 deaths. That is one-fifth of all deaths. It contributes significantly to Scotland's unfair and unjust health inequalities as both a cause and effect. Smoking rates have reduced from 31% of the adult population in 1999 to 17% in 2019. But we still have some way to go if we're to meet our ambition of 5% or less by 2034. When asked, 66% of smokers want to quit. A clear majority of respondents to the 2019 consultation on these regulations supported these proposals. Around 70%, in fact, over 70% supported these proposals. And they see the benefits of removing tobacco smoke from NHS properties. And I think it's now time to make that a reality. And with that, I'm happy to take any questions the committee may have.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. We have a couple of members wanting to ask questions. Paul, OK?
Thank you very much, convener, and thank you to the Cabinet Secretary for that statement. I think this legislation is supported and attracts a degree of support, I think, as you outlined. I suppose the question I have relates to the responsibility for enforcement. I think the big challenge with many of these interventions are if they're not enforced, then very often I think people become frustrated by that. I note from the papers that the duty will fall upon local authorities and environmental health officers within local authorities to enforce. And I suppose linked to that really is what does that mean in terms of financial implication for local authorities? And of course, I point to my register of interest as an outgoing local authority councillor. But we know that throughout the pandemic, there was extra pressure upon environmental health teams in terms of enforcement of coronavirus regulations. We know that that came with a cost. I noticed from the financial effects paragraph within the report that there won't be additional funding because it's expected that additional costs will be covered under existing budgets, but I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary will agree that local councils are stretched. There are huge challenges in terms of the finances available. So I wonder what scope there is to kind of look at the workload, to review the workload as this is implemented and consider what extra resources might be required. Thank you.
Yeah, so it's a good point. So I would say two things. One is that although there is a fixed penalty potential, there is a fixed penalty or the potential of a fixed penalty if you do not comply. We do hope that the introduction of these regulations, if they are passed, will enact behavioural change. And I think the vast overwhelming majority of people will behave responsibly and make sure they are out with the perimeter if they are wanting to continue smoking. In terms, so that's one point I'd make. The second point is an important one, and one I will agree with Paul O'Kane that we will continue to keep the issue absolutely under review. It should be said that in the Scottish in the local government settlement, there is baseline funding of £2.8 million to Scotland's local authorities to support measures related to tobacco control. So there is their money and baselined, and that's why we don't think there's a need for any additional funding. And certainly, I've not heard that articulated to me from COSLA, but his question to me to keep that under review is one that I will commit to doing.
Thank you. I'm joining us online with Sandesh Kulhani. Sandesh.
Thank you, convener. Cabinet Secretary, behavioural change is very important. Of course it is. But let me give you two examples. When I was at York Hill Children's Hospital, people were smoking by a big sign with a picture of a sick child saying, please don't smoke here, it drifts up to my window. When I was in Forth Valley, they have done more than I've seen other hospitals doing. They have signs, big signs everywhere. There's also cross-hatching on the floor saying, do not smoke here. And they employed somebody who went round to tell people not to smoke there, and tried to take details and tried to issue fines, as was the right thing for him to do. He's a lovely guy, but people just abused him and ignored him, and they ignore these things. And getting behavioural change when you're standing in front of a picture of a sick kid smoking, that is something that's going to be really difficult. So initially, as with the smoking ban indoors, it needs to be policed, and it needs to be policed with teeth. And that's something that I think I'm picking up from Paul O'Kane as well. And we need to police that really well to start with, especially to start with, to get and kickstart the behavioural change. So would you be able to relook at this and see what we can do to really clamp down in those initial phases?
I think the point is well made. I think the point is well made that in the beginning of introducing these regulations, again, if they're passed by this committee in Parliament, then we will ensure that there's good education and public knowledge about the regulations coming into place, which they would be in September. So there's a period of time for us to really ramp up the communications around this. I think that's really important for us to do. I take Sandesh Kulhani's point, though, that people maybe aren't paying attention to the current voluntary ban that's in place, even if there's pictures of sick children saying don't smoke because your smoke drifts up to potentially drifts up to my room. you know, I think that's where the enforcement element could be quite crucial. You know, £50 is a really expensive fag to have. You know, it's a really expensive cigarette to end up smoking if you have to pay that fixed penalty notice. And there may be some health boards in conjunction with the local authorities at the beginning of the regulation choose to just make sure they are clamping down on those who are ignoring it. Now, I would always expect that, as we've done throughout the pandemic, that there would be a really sensible approach to enforcement. I don't think it would be heavy-handed to begin with, but if people are ignoring and continue to ignore, then, of course, that option for a fixed penalty does exist. And I think some people being hit in their pocket and realising that this is something that has to be done, isn't voluntary, may well be something that we see across the country. But I would hope that the vast majority of those individuals who do smoke, one, they would understand the change in the regulation through our communication, but secondly, that they would comply.
Sandesh, should we get any other questions? No, I don't think he does. Can I come to Emma Harper?
Yep, thanks, Convener. Good morning again, Cabinet Secretary. I'm interested in how the regulations will be communicated to the local authorities and health boards. And just because of the... I know, as a nurse, the exacerbations of COPD that lead to hospital admissions and the Respiratory Care Action Plan that's now been you know, developed and then delivered. And tomorrow I'm actually heading to Belfast to talk at the Breath Project, which is about COPD causes prevention and treatment. So I think it's welcome that we have these regulations. So how is this going to be communicated to our local authorities and health board areas?
Yeah, so again, when it comes to the signage, we will provide absolutely that, but also we'll work with providing information on the ban, and enforcement will be available to patients in different languages, which I think is quite important as well. Although the no smoking symbol, I think, is an internationally recognised no smoking symbol, and that's why it's obviously used. That being said, the information on it will be really important. So we will work really closely with health boards. I think there is a period, if the regulation is passed, and I've got every confidence it will be, the period between now and it coming into force is going to be really important for us. So we'll make sure it's communicated well, that there is a lot of attention on this particular ban coming into place, and actually the consequences of ignoring it are also in place too. So that is all work that is currently being discussed between ourselves and local partners in advance of hopefully this regulation being passed.
Okay.
Thanks, Convener. Do you see any difficulty around enforcement where a 15-metre no-smoking zone encompasses areas which are obviously not part of a hospital ground, such as public footpaths?
Potentially, people might think they're far enough away, and that's why the signage is going to be really important, effectively, to continue to reinforce the message that you are still within the no-smoking perimeter. And my hope is that for the vast majority of people, that, you know, that walk 15 metres away is enough for them not to have to light up and have a cigarette. But for some people, they will still wish to smoke, and therefore, that's why there is a need for a period of time to be able to remove smoking shelters, for example, that are within that 15 metre boundary, and make sure they're out with that 15 metre boundary. But I would hope that if there are areas for smoking, that they're obviously out with the perimeter, that they are people are cognizant of footpaths, areas that people walk in, and so on and so forth, because it's an unpleasant experience if you're not a smoker, having to walk past a crowded smoking shelter and catching that secondhand smoke. And we know the dangers of secondhand smoke that are well articulated by a number of studies and third sector organisations, particularly, I think, of the good work that Roy Castle Foundation does in that regard.
Excellent. I'm not seeing any other colleagues. Yes, Paul?
Sorry, I think just following on from that point, obviously the regulations, as I understand it, cover hospitals particularly,
yep.
But I mean, does the Cabinet Secretary feel that there's scope to extend that? I mean, particularly given that we now have a number of health and social care centres, very often in our town centres, that are new builds, that are well used, that have treatment rooms and all the rest of it. I mean, is there a sense that we should be looking to extend this across the estate more widely?
Yeah, I mean, short answer to that is yes. I think we're starting because we obviously already have the voluntary ban in place for NHS hospitals, and I should say as NHS hospitals we are talking about here, and therefore it's perhaps easier to turn that voluntary ban into something in statute. But the problem is probably more acute in our hospital sites, given the size, the scale of those hospital sites. It's maybe less pronounced at a GP surgery, for example. You're less likely to come by. I'm not saying it's impossible, but probably less likely to come by somebody smoking at the entrance of your GP surgery. In comparison to a hospital site. So definitely open-minded to that, but I hope it's understood the logic of why we're progressing with this step first.
Thank you. Just looking across to my colleagues to see if there's any other questions. I don't think there are. We'll now move on to agenda item 4, which is the formal debate on the made affirmative instrument in which we've just taken the evidence. And can I remind the committee that members should not put questions to the Minister, Cabinet Secretary, during the formal debate, and officials may not speak in the debate. Cabinet Secretary, before I invite you to move, is there any further you wish to say in relation to motion S6M03434?
No closing remarks to make.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, can I ask you to formally move the motion S6M03434 in your name?
I contend to move the motion in my name.
Thank you. The question then is that motion S6M03434 be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. Thank you. And that concludes the consideration of the instrument. I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary and his officials for attending today's meeting. At our next meeting on the 19th of April, the committee will take evidence from the Auditor General for Scotland on Audit Scotland's NHS in Scotland 2021 report. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thank you all.
Thank you. Well, thank you. Thank you.